be moved. My feet are on the rock. I can feel the water.
Good morning, church. Good morning, fellow human beings. Wherever you are and whenever you are, when you are listening to this message, may the blessing of Jesus be with you in this moment, and may you be blessed by the word of God as it is reaching you now. It's such an interesting time that we are living in now, and I think all of us have experienced one of the amazing things that we are seeing happening in the church is that the church is responding, the global church is responding in an amazing way by the challenge of this coronavirus and COVID-19. And there are so many positive messages out there that reach us from all kinds of ways, that uplift us and that take us forward day by day, and that help us to deal with and to process with this very, very intense piece of history that is playing out in front of our eyes. What we've experienced here in Hartbeespoort in South Africa over the past few days was that first there was a cloud cover that came over this area, and then for the past 2 days really it just rained and rained and rained and rained. And what my wife and I, what we felt in our spirit is that the Lord is really just washing and just washing and just washing. And one of the things that we started talking about last week, we discussed the connections that Jesus made by the cross. And I really feel and believe that this season is also a season in which the Lord is washing and cleansing us, and washing and cleansing the world in a certain way. It's a season in which the Holy Spirit is showing us where some of the stuff is that we really need to get rid of, and that we need to just get clear and get out of the way. And the message that I want to share with you today is a message of that. It's a message that helps us to identify, specifically in connections, that helps us to identify where are some of these areas perhaps which we now have an opportunity to identify and to wash clean with the blood of Jesus and with the help of the Holy Spirit. So before we get into all of that, let's just close our eyes and let's pray to our King and our Savior. Thank you, Jesus, once again for this amazing opportunity to reach out to your church through time and space. Lord, we know that there might be people that are watching this in a different time than when it was recorded. We know that people are watching this in different physical spaces than where it was recorded, Lord, and we just want to glorify your name for the fact that we have technology, and we know that technology also comes from you, and that you've provided us technology where we can do these things, where we are able to reach out to our family, our church family, and that we can have fellowship even though we are not physically together. Lord, we want to ask that you bless every mouth, every ear, every eye in this time now, wherever these people are and wherever they are watching and listening, that the message of your word will come forth and that it will pierce their hearts and their minds, Lord, and find good ground to shoot root and to grow from. Lord, we want to pray in this moment that nothing that I say is of myself, Lord, that it's just your spirit flowing through, and that it is just your word, Lord, that will reach out to your church. Lord, we acknowledge that all the people that we are now talking to and that we are engaging with, Lord, it's all your church, it's your people. And we thank you that we have this amazing opportunity to reach them in their homes or wherever they are. Thank you, Jesus, for your everlasting grace. Thank you for the power that you have showed in your word, and the power that we see manifest every day around the world. Lord, we dedicate also the entire country of South Africa and the world, Lord. We dedicate it to you, and we say thank you, Lord, that we know that you are in control, and that you that you've always been in control, and that when we are through this journey, when we are done with this season, that your name will be glorified. In the name of Jesus, amen, amen. In last week's message, we explored how the cross was the connection, the reconnection between ourselves and God, between ourselves and the inner being, between ourselves and creation, and between ourselves and our fellow human beings and others. And in the center of that cross is Jesus. So if we want to explore the way that we connect with people, and we want to go into a season where we ask the Holy Spirit to wash us clean from connections that are not godly, and the way that we connect that are not, or ways that we connect that are not godly, what better way to do that than by putting Jesus between ourselves and our connections? And the way in which we can do that is by just looking at the life of Jesus on earth, and how he modeled connections when he was wandering the earth, and when he was engaging with people and connecting with people, and ask the Holy Spirit to point out some of these things, perhaps, that we can look at and that we can adjust, so that when we go back into the world after this season of isolation and internal reflection, that the connections that we then make with the world externally again, that those connections will be of high quality, that it will be godly, and that it will be in his purpose and bringing his kingdom to earth, right in the middle of that. So if the cross is the connection, and we know that Jesus is in the center, then Jesus is the connector. And in the lead up to this discussion with you all, I had a bit of a study, and I asked the Holy Spirit to just show me from Jesus's life how we can see how he connected with people, how he modeled the connections that we have with people. And it was very interesting. Of course, in the Word there are so many examples, and really want to encourage you to just in the Gospels, just to read again from the context of connection, just read again those Gospels and just experience what Jesus is sharing with you in terms of how he connected with people and why you connected with people. So if we look at his life, there are various stages in which we can see certain connections being made. And there's a lot of things that we can deduce from that. The first stage that we obviously see is his birth. And from his birth, we can really see the importance of a human connection and the vulnerability of a human connection to God. We read in John 1:1, and this is also a scripture that we mentioned last week, but it's such a powerful scripture. I'm going to read out from the Amplified. So if you have your Bibles, you can read with me. If you don't have your Bibles, once again, go and just pause the video and go and collect your Bibles quickly. In John 1:1 in the Amplified, we read that in the beginning, before all time, was the Word, which is Christ, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God himself. He was continually existing in the beginning, co-eternally with God. This is Jesus. All things were made and came into existence through him, and without him, not even one thing was made that has come into being. In him was life, and the power to bestow life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines on in the darkness, and the darkness did not understand it, or overpower it, or appropriate it, or absorb it, and is unreceptive to it. So it's amazing to think that Jesus came to earth as a human being, and yet he was the King of the universe before that. He was God. He was the Word, and he still is the Word, but he made himself vulnerable and came to earth in that vulnerable position. In John 1, in verse 14, we read, "And the Word Christ became flesh and lived among us. And we actually saw his glory, glory as belongs to the one and only begotten Son of the Father, the Son who is truly unique, the only one of his kind, who is full of grace and truth, absolutely free of deception." And it's amazing when you put these two scriptures together and you realize that the word that had creating power and that we read about in Genesis 1 verse 1 and the story in Genesis that we spoke about last week, how that amazing power of creation was now being made vulnerable and being made flesh on earth. And one cannot help but wonder why that was necessary. Why was it necessary for such a powerful being, for God, that we all know and that we can see the immense power of God around us? Why was it necessary for Jesus to come to earth as a human being, as flesh? And I think one of the reasons, although there are many, but one of the reasons is that he had to make an authentic connection. He needed to make a connection to us. He needed to show us that he knows exactly what we're going through. And by knowing what we are going through and suffering the same pain and the same turmoils and the same temptations for sin as us, as human beings, only then can he really connect with us as human beings and be able to lead us to salvation. The second stage that we see in Jesus's journey on earth and how he operated as a human being in terms of connections was through his life. And there's obviously a lot that we can take from his life. I think it was actually quite a challenge for me to isolate only a few things that I can share with you, things that I feel really to be prominent in terms of connection. But there are just so many things that we can take from Jesus's life in terms of how he operated and how he dealt with people. So his life showed us the significance of community and what deep, meaningful connections look like. And I think his whole story on earth is a story of connections. And it's very interesting and significant when we start exploring that and reading into that and asking the Holy Spirit to reveal what Jesus was trying to show us when he walked on the earth. So he showed us, he modeled some key ways, some significant ways in which we can connect to people. The first one that I identified as I read through the Gospels was that his connections were always intentional or purposeful. He never connected by random or without a purpose. There was always a mission. There was always a reason why he connected with somebody. And I think that's part of the reason why there was so much significance in his connections, is because there was purpose. It wasn't just a random connection. And I think as we read through this in our spiritual life and we try to see what Jesus modeled for us in our spiritual life, it's important to understand that when we go through life, there are various types of connections. There are connections that we make on a functional level, connections that we make perhaps at our kids' school or at work, or connections that we make on a level of entertainment or sport. And those connections are all good and well. But when we talk about spiritual connections, it's something else. It's a connection that we feel is resonating deep in our hearts and in our spirit. And I really believe what Jesus is trying to show us in the Word and in the Gospels is how he connected with people on a spiritual level. So if we explore firstly into this intentional and purposeful dimension of the way that he connected, we read in Matthew 9 in verse 35, "Then Jesus made a circuit of all the towns and villages. He taught in their meeting places, reported kingdom news, and healed their diseased bodies. He healed their bruised and hurt lives. When he looked out over the crowds, his heart broke. So confused and aimless they were, like sheep with no shepherd. And he said to his disciples, 'What a huge harvest. How few workers. On your knees and pray for harvest hands.'" Now this is the end of chapter 9. And then right at the beginning of chapter 10, we read that the prayer was no sooner prayed than it was answered. Jesus called 12 of his followers and sent them into the ripe fields. He gave them power to kick out evil spirits and to tenderly care for the bruised and hurt lives. This is the list of the 12 he sent. And then he lists, of course, the 12 disciples that he sent into this ripe field, into his ministry at that point in time. And it's amazing when we ask the question, but why did he have disciples? I mean, he's God, right? So God can do everything, anything. Why is it necessary for him to have disciples? And we read here in his word that connection with the disciples, and when he called the disciples, were intentional. He said there that he sees the harvest as as plentiful, but the workers are few. And he commissions his disciples and send them out into this world. And it's that commissioning, that mission that we are still to this day, that we are following, that we are striving towards, is to bring in that harvest for God. So what is significant about that is, and we know to this day, is that Jesus, even in that space, he needed hands and feet. He needs people to execute his will on earth. He needs people to step into their calling and to do what he called them to do. We know from scripture as well that the scripture tells us that faith without action is dead. And we can see it in this case as well. It's good and well to observe and to identify that there's a lot of work to be done, but unless somebody does it, it doesn't actually make a difference. So we need a connection in fellowship to activate our faith. And I think that's such an important thing that we experience on a weekly basis at church, is that for us to be able to connect with the people in our congregation, in our church, to have fellowship with them, activates our faith. It takes something that we believe and something that we say, and it puts it into action. And what's powerful about such a fellowship environment, and the same as we experience in Church Arise and Church Connect, is that we are able there to connect with people that's connecting to our purpose. And really, that is what it's all about. And even in this context of where we read Jesus sending out his disciples, is that Jesus had a purpose. He was sent to earth for a specific reason. He came to earth for a specific reason. And he connected to these people that was connected to his purpose. And I really think it's so important for us to just keep a close eye on that. And even in this season, as we're going through now, is to reevaluate the connections that we are making and to make sure that we are connecting for the reason of following our purpose, to activate our purpose and to follow through on our purpose. So if we look at this first principle of Jesus' life and how he connected with people, the fact that it was intentional and purposeful, in the season that we are now, in this lockdown season, I think it's a really amazing opportunity for us to just take one step back, to look at the connections that we are making and asking ourselves, but are we intentional about the things that we are doing and the connections that we are making? And in this specific season, is there anybody that we can reach out and connect to that we think we can help? Is there somebody or somewhere that Jesus pressed on our hearts right in this moment where our intention can be to reach out to those people and connect in a specific way to help them out in an hour of need? The second dimension that we see Jesus demonstrate when he lived his life on earth is that his connections were always authentic and real. And in some cases, when you read about his journey on earth and what he did, it's almost cringeworthy how he operated and how real, authentic, and really was. And to me, it was really encouraging, and it was something that really prompted me to inspect my heart and just to ask a question, but how authentic and real am I about the connections that I'm making? If you read in Matthew 5, it's probably the most straightforward and plainly put version of how Jesus approached this real connection. And in the message, it says it so nice. He says in verse 33, "And don't say anything you don't mean. This counsel is embedded deep in our traditions. You only make things worse when you lay down a smokescreen of pious talk, saying, 'I'll pray for you,' and never doing it, or saying, 'God be with you,' and not meaning it. You don't make your words true by embellishing them with religious lace. In making your speech sound more religious, it becomes less true. Just say yes and no. When you manipulate words to get your own way, you go wrong." And this was part of the Sermon on the Mount, in the first portion of the Sermon on the Mount. And there are so many things that we can take from the Sermon on the Mount. But to me, in terms of the connections that we are making and the connections that Jesus was making, this was so striking to me. And it made me think about the scripture where we read that the word is like a two-edged sword that will cut through what is real and what is not real, what is a lie and what is truth. And it's almost uncomfortable reading this and applying it on our own lives and thinking about how real the connections are that we're making. What is significant also about this is that to be authentic and to be real in terms of the connections, we need to understand our purpose and our intention. So the first portion that Jesus is illustrating in terms of the intentionality of connection, flows through into the authenticity. If we understand our purpose and we understand the intention behind our connections, we can be real about it. And Jesus really encourages us to do that. So for me, and I think in the season, in this time, it is an opportunity for us to just sit back and to ask, but how real are we in terms of the connections that we are making? How real are we in the ways that we respond and the things that we are saying? In today's life, and we touched on this last week as well, is that in this age of social media and WhatsApp, where it's so easy to send things on, are we real about the things that we are saying and that we are doing? If we're saying that there's somebody in need and we put in a WhatsApp message a prayer hand, are we actually praying? Are we stepping into that? And it's a convicting thing to think about when we press into that and when we consider that and when we ask the Holy Spirit to point out the things where we still need to grow and where we still need to become more real and more authentic. So in this season, what are the things that we can point out in our lives where our connections maybe have not been that truthful or not that authentic? What are the things that we've grown accustomed to saying and doing, which perhaps is not aligned with this modeling of what we see Jesus doing when he was walking the earth? The third thing we see from Jesus' life on earth and as he wandered earth and engaged with people is that he was no respecter of person, which means that he had no favoritism. And to me, I must be honest, that was a new concept to me. I've never heard that word, respecter of person, as I prepared for sharing this message with you. But it really describes it so well in the New King James Version, where he says that God is no respecter of person. And what is amazing to me is if I ask any of you about the story of the fish and the bread and the multiplication and the feeding, and I ask about how many people did he feed, you would most likely say to me, well, 5,000, of course. But what is so interesting is that there's two of these stories back to back. And you really should go and read it if you're not familiar with the two stories. But the first story is where he fed the 5,000, which was in the Jewish territory. So that was where he preached to Jews, and he healed a lot of Jews in that space. And he said to his disciples that his heart goes out to these people because he thinks they must be hungry. And he asked them, and then the disciples said, well, let's send them home to go and get food, and then and then they can come back. And Jesus said, no, you will feed them. And then, of course, there's a whole story about how they collected the fish and the bread. He broke it. He gave it to the disciples. And they eventually fed 5,000 men without the women and children counted. But what is so interesting is that in the very next chapter, Jesus is going on the eastern shores of the sea. And he enters into Gentile territory, as it were, at the day. And the very same thing happens. The very same thing happens. He's positioned on a hill, and then multitudes of people come. He heals them. He drives out demons. And again, he says to his disciples, my heart goes out to these people because they've been following me for a while, and they don't have anything to eat. But the disciples' response is really fascinating. Their response at this time is that, well, they don't have anything to give them. And again, Jesus said, well, what do you have left? And it's fish and bread again. And he feeds 4,000 men without counting the women and children. And the response of the disciples really is the interesting thing here, because Jesus went out to both Jews and Gentiles. He did the same thing. He felt the same way. His heart went out to both. He healed both groups. But the disciples' response was a bit different. In the Jewish countryside, in the Jewish region, they felt, you know, compassion equally. And they said, well, you know, we let's send the people home. And then eventually they ended up feeding them. But in the Gentile country, their response was almost standoffish, to say, well, we don't really have anything we can give them. And not feeling the same level of compassion as Jesus felt. And there are so many other stories that we read about. We read about the centurion, which was a Gentile, that came to Jesus and said, look, just command it and it will happen. And Jesus said of him that he's had the most faith of anybody that he's seen. There was the Gentile woman that came to him and that asked for him to help him set her daughter free from an evil spirit or from a demonic possession. And he approached all of these people without favoritism or prejudice. You know, this season maybe is a good opportunity for us to just think about this and to prepare our hearts for when we come out of this isolation period, how we will engage with people going forward. Because if God is bringing a connection to your doorstep and it is aligned with your purpose, we are called to act on it, irrespective of our own preconceived ideas or, you know, what we believe people, worthy people are for our time and our effort. And then comes the really good news. In his resurrection, we see the power of connection with the Holy Spirit and how we can reconnect to God. So what is amazing also about what we see in how Jesus's life played out on earth is that he always connected heavenly before he connected earthly. He operated from the Father. And we read in John 5 verse 30, he says, I can do nothing on my own initiative or authority. And this is Jesus. This is Jesus speaking. We just read in John 1:1 how he is the Word and how that he was there from all time. But he demonstrates to us while he is on earth that he can do nothing on his own initiative and authority. And he says, just as I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just, fair, righteous, and unbiased, because I do not seek my own will, but only the will of him who sent me. And it's such an amazing and a powerful demonstration that he gives us, that there's nothing that Jesus does without having that alignment from the Father. And if you read about his life and we see that there's this intention and purpose, we know that he knows that what he's doing is in his intention, is in his purpose and with intention, because he's connected to the Father. Even in this time, as we go through this very challenging season, is if we can stay connected to the Father and we just ask the Father, ask Abba to lead us through this and to help us through all the challenges that might be coming from this, is that we know that he will give us each step of the way and every purpose that we are supposed to fulfill. And then there's an amazing piece in my research that I found from Dan Spader. And he said in this lecture that he wrote, he said that what is also amazing about Jesus' life is that he always operated by the Spirit. As Jesus, he operated by the Spirit. And he writes here, Jesus modeled full dependence upon the Holy Spirit. The scriptures are very clear. Every aspect of Jesus' life and ministry was saturated with the Spirit of God. Jesus was conceived by the Spirit in Luke 1. He was anointed by the Spirit in Luke 4. He was filled with the Spirit in Luke 4 and John 3. He was sealed by the Spirit in John 6. He was led by the Spirit in Luke 4. He rejoiced in the Spirit in Luke 10. He gave commands by the Spirit, as we read in Acts 1. He performed miracles by the power of the Spirit in Matthew 12 and Luke 4. He was resurrected by the Spirit, as we read in Romans 8, and through the Spirit presented himself fully obedient, as we read in Hebrews 9. And the amazing news for us is, as we all know, is that we have access to this Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit the whole time, and we read in Romans 8, verse 9. However, you are not living in the flesh controlled by the sinful nature, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God lives in you, directing and guiding you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him and is not a child of God. If Christ lives in you through your natural body is dead because of sin, your spirit is alive because of righteousness which he provides. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give you life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. And what we can take away from this is that we see how Jesus modeled these things, how he modeled these connections that we should make and the way that we should connect to people. But by being tapped into the Spirit, we know that we would be able to make our connections with intention, to make our connections with authenticity, and to be very real about our connections, and to not have any favoritism in the connections that we are making. And I think in this season that we are in now, it is such an amazing opportunity for us to just take some introspect. And because we are cut off from many of the connections that we have on a daily basis prior to this isolation period, to just inspect those and just to ask Holy Spirit to just show us the things and the areas in our lives where we can make these subtle changes and step back into what his purpose is for us and to be aligned with the Spirit. The lockdown really turned our house into not only a household, but also a business and a school, and it all happened within a matter of days. So it really is quite busy, as you can imagine. But at the same time, there's also a lot less noise. And I really don't know how to explain it, but I know that you all know exactly what I mean. There's a lot more time for reflection, even although it might be amidst busyness. And I want to end this message and just ask you to take the opportunity of the next 2 weeks, the two remaining weeks of this lockdown, and really press deep into this reflection and the opportunity we have for a bit of less outside noise to think about our connections. Maybe if you're not used to journaling, maybe start a journal. If you like journaling, it's a perfect opportunity to write this down for reflection afterwards. Maybe you want to start a blog, or maybe you want to post on Facebook, or maybe if you're really willing to challenge yourself, maybe you can ask people around you to give you some feedback about these questions for reflection. So in the next coming weeks, some of the things that you can reflect on in terms of your connections are the following. Are you clear on your purpose, and are you connecting in line with your purpose? Is there a specific need that you see around you, something that you've always been aware of, or something perhaps now that you've become aware of that needs a response and a connection to alleviate that need and to meet that need? Are you really authentic in your words and in your actions? And this is really something where, if you want to challenge yourself, to ask people around you to give you feedback on whether you are really authentic in what you say and what you do. Are you real? In times of trouble or in normal everyday life, do you connect heavenly before you connect earthly? Or do you sometimes make and establish and maintain connections from the flesh? And then finally, if you model and continue to model your connections on Jesus, how can you see certain aspects of your life change? And how can you see things work differently in your life? Church, it's been an absolute pleasure to once again share a message with you through the cyberspace, or the interwebs, as some people might say. We really want to bless you in this week. We want to bless you in this season. We want to also encourage you that irrespective of what the truths are that is, or the supposed truths that are spread around this virus and around the world about what's going to happen, we want to encourage you and say that there's a much higher truth, there's a bigger truth, there's a real truth, and that is Jesus. And his promises is what we stand on. Be blessed. My feet are on the rock.